Welcome to Community on Purpose, a podcast for the leader inside of you. On this podcast, we'll explore how women everywhere are intentionally creating community through business, giving, and living. Our conversations will uncover the power of community and the difference living in alignment can make in our world. This podcast is brought to you by the Amy Jones Group, your residential real estate team serving the East Valley. On a mission to thrive, the Amy Jones Group is committed to helping you go further, faster, through home ownership and community giving. For more information, visit amyjonesgroup.com. Welcome back to another episode of Community on Purpose, where we're chatting with women across the valley who are intentionally creating community through business, giving, and living. It's been another awesome week of meeting women who are really taking their personal lives and their professional goals and mashing them together and creating something really unique, something intentional, and something that they feel that they can really strive in. One of the messages that I've heard from a lot of the folks on our podcast to date is really about the necessity of creating and curating the world around the women in order for them really to live their best and biggest lives. This is Mindy Jones. I am your host. I am the owner of the Amy Jones Group and founder of Community on Purpose, a nonprofit organization serving women in leadership and business, an organization supporting youth and families. On today's podcast, we're going to be talking to Leanna DeBellevue. She's an international speaker, global marketing agency owner, social media strategist, co-author of the Amazon International bestseller, Light at the End of the Funnel, a practical guide for business owners who are ready to step into success, and someone that I hope I can always call my friend. Leanna, welcome to the podcast.
Thank you for having me.
Hey, I so appreciate you joining us today. We've got a lot to cover because you do a lot. Yes. You mom, you wife, you business owner.
Yes.
I think we actually met through the chamber. Is that right?
Yes. Yep.
So the Gilbert Chamber of Commerce, which you'll hear about quite a bit on the podcast. I think lots of people who come through our studio talk about the different ways that they've been able to connect with their community. And a lot of times the chamber is a sort of a first stop for them. And Leanna and I actually connected through the Women Empowered Committee, which is a group that is a part of the chamber, and recently put on an event together that was all about showing up authentically and living your best and biggest life. And Leanna, you were vulnerable enough to get on stage and talk about some of the challenges that you've had. And it was so great because I think part of building community is about being vulnerable, being open, trying to find other people that are on the same journey as us.
Absolutely.
I'm going to ask you today a lot about what you think about community, what it means, how it's shown up for you. But for those who haven't met you, can you take us back a little bit and share a little bit about your upbringing?
Sure. So I am an original California girl. I was one of the Valley girls in the 90s. Didn't realize I sounded like a Valley girl until I get around my friends and we kind of transitioned back into that. But grew up in Pasadena, California. Went to a private university in East Texas, which took me from California to Texas. Was pre-med. Thought I was going to be a pediatrician from the time I was 6 or 8. I knew that that's what I wanted to be. Got into the classes and then found out that the world had a little bit of a different idea of what I should do because I found out I was pregnant with my daughter. So med school and motherhood was at an early age probably wasn't the smartest route for me to take. So decided to be a stay-at-home mom. I was a stay-at-home mom for quite a while. Decided that I still wanted to be in the medical field and went in to the nursing program. I thought I can't be a doctor, but I can be a nurse. Got accepted into the program. 2 weeks before it was supposed to start, I found out I was pregnant with my son. So that was a no. ended up being a stay-at-home mom. And we moved to Arizona from Texas to be closer to my husband at the time. His family was here and kind of made Arizona our home.
Don't those kids just show up whenever they want to?
I know, right?
What I love, though, is being a mom is obviously something that we talk about quite a bit on this podcast, and how it and those roles intersect with the choices that we make. And now, as someone who owns their own business, and I do want you to talk a lot about that today as well, I know that choices that you make around marriage and family, they really play a role in how you structure your day, your business, your goals.
Absolutely. I think so many times I tell my husband now, I don't think my children think I work, or no one thinks that I work, because they don't see when I get up at 4 a.m. to take a conference call that's, you know, in Europe that's 6 hours ahead of us, or, you know, or they don't see that I go to bed, or, you know, after they go to bed, then I sit down and do emails. I really have created a life intentionally to where I didn't miss any games. I didn't miss, you know, kind of programs at school. I didn't do any of these things so that they would have that experience of having their mom there, but they don't see all the back end of what it takes to get, you know, to that level in business.
So one of the things we talk about a lot is community and what it means and how it shows up for you. As you journeyed as a young mom, you switched courses and careers. I'm sure that those were difficult times to navigate. You also moved from one location to another, so I'm sure there's a whole other element of having to meet new people and find your footing. Can you walk us through some of those challenges that you saw and how you sought out or created your own community?
Yeah. I think as I get older now, I realize the impact of community, and it holds a very big part of my decision making when it comes to business and who I connect with and why I connect with them, and being intentional about that. Now looking back in those times of difficulty, I've always had an amazing community around me. I didn't have the term community. I didn't necessarily identify, but when I look back and I think what got me over those struggles, it was amazing mentors that just, you know, I was introduced to, or other moms that were going through similar, you know, experiences and things along those lines. And looking back, I realized that there's no way I could have had anywhere near the level of success, not necessarily just in business, but in motherhood, in general adulthood, right, without that community. And because I know what it's done for me, I actively seek it out, because I know that that's how I get to be the best version of myself, if that makes sense.
It does, absolutely. And I think that those challenges are often what ends up catapulting your success, right? They're the things that help you define and get clarity around what really is important to you, what you want to be or don't want to be, how you want to show up. And I know from personal experience, I glean something new from every person that I meet, and then kind of look at the way that they're doing something and see, is it something that I can learn from? Is it something that I haven't been exposed to before? Does it feel right to me? Do I need to tweak it a little bit? So I can imagine going through all of those life changes that you picked up little things that worked for you. Yeah. And probably a lot of things that didn't work for you along the way.
I had to find my 20s right there. A bunch of didn't work.
Right? Yeah. Most all the didn't work stuff. So being a young mom, can you now share, reflecting back over the last couple of decades, what is your family structure look like today?
It looks like I never imagined it to. So I was always told, don't have more than two kids, more kids than you have hands. So I had one boy, one girl. I thought I was done. Totally happy with that. Got to, my children were 17 and 19. And that's when I met my current husband. And I had always just had two kids. And they were, my son was 17, almost 18, so I thought I was done. I didn't realize that parenting is never done, but in my head, I thought I was almost done. Like, I saw light at the end of the tunnel, and I met my husband, and at the time, he had an 8-year-old, an 11-year-old, and a 13-year-old, and I thought, well, you know, this can't be that hard. Like, I've already done two, three is just one more. Well, little did I, like, I wasn't thinking that that would be five total, right? So we, from then we had, and at the time my daughter had had her son. So I was, we had a grandbaby in the house who, when I met my husband, he was a year. He had just turned a year. So at one time when we first got together, all six were in the house. And at that point we were already living together and, you know, married. And I was like, oh man, this is a lot. Maybe I should have realized we should have counted them all before we, you know, kind of made any decisions. But it motherhood has evolved in so many different ways. Like going from mothering small children to teenagers to now adults. And then there's the stepmom role. And then there's the Lolly role. I'm not old enough to be a grandma, so I call myself Lolly, right?
Good one.
We have him about 75 to 85% of the time, so we are pretty much raising him. So it feels like we're starting all over again.
Mm-hmm. What has changed for you about parenting today than it did when you're older, too, or younger?
I think because I was so young when I had mine, I was always worried about what people would say because I was so young. I wanted to make sure that everything looked perfect and they were always, you know, everything always had to kind of fit what I thought everyone else's ideal situation looked like, right? And I was not very patient, right? I didn't have enough life under my belt to really kind of appreciate the time of them being little, right? I was just in the middle of it, right? I'm trying to learn how to pay bills and be a new wife and be, you know, all of these things. And so it looks completely different. Now, like when we have Caden, I'm kind of cherishing these moments because I realize now how fast it goes, how quickly it goes. It seems like yesterday my two little ones were his size and now they're, you know, they're full adults. And just understanding that parenting is not about what everyone else thinks. It's about the experience that you can provide for your child and how to raise them to be really good people. And it's so much deeper than just, you know, what outfit or does the bow coordinate with the shoes that coordinates with the, you know, the backpack and stuff along those lines. So I think Caden is having, and I guess all four of the younger ones are having a different experience than my two older ones had.
Which is really the beauty of a woman's intuition is that it has the space to evolve. And I think, you know, one of the things that I see most challenging in relationships between men and women is that women, I feel like, have this natural ability to evolve. They easily learn and grow and they're intuitive and they mold and meld and move depending on what's happening in their situation. And as life progresses, the people in your world, they have to be committed, right, to that journey. And I bring that up because I know that having an intentional marriage and a committed intentional marriage is something that's really important to you and to your husband.
Yeah.
Do you want to share anything about kind of your thoughts about that? I know, you know, it's a topic that comes up quite a bit for women who run their own business and have kids and are trying to show up in all of the areas.
Yeah.
And we know it's never perfect and it doesn't always look perfect.
Yeah.
And it takes work, right? With grit comes commitment.
Yeah, true. I feel like my marriage now has evolved and changed almost as drastically as my parenting, my two older ones. You know, I think it's really easy to let kids be your entire world. And I'm a mom. I love unconditionally and I love passionately, you know, like, but at the same time, I think in the past I lost sight of who my partner was and I kind of made my kids my partner. And that just wasn't, it's not healthy for anybody, right? That's not what marriage is designed to be. And when I met my husband, Jeff, we were both adamant that we were never getting married again because we both had, you know, had these long-term marriages that were really hard. And we just knew we never wanted to do it again, right? And it was funny because going into it with that attitude of I don't ever want to do it again, and then a few months later we were married, right? We had really honest conversations about do we really want to do this? And if we do, what did we do wrong? Like taking personal ownership for our past relationships. Where do I need to grow? What could I have done better? How could I have shown up for my partner? And being honest with ourselves and each other really kind of gave us some boundaries. And we honestly have a list of non-negotiables for our marriage. And there's certain things that we know is what it's going to take to keep that marriage healthy. And because we work so hard at it, it has kind of filtered down into our parenting. They see what relationships are supposed to look like and what, you know, healthy looks like and what boundaries look like and all of these things that I didn't have. Again, I don't think I had enough life under me before. I have the utmost respect when I see people who have been married for, you know, 20, 30, 40 years, because I know that they have had to evolve and change and grow together. And that's, I think it's hard enough to do that on your own, but to do that with someone else and to be able to do it in a way that complements each other, that is the most beautiful thing to me, you know?
What are some resources that you would share? And then I want to transition into some of the other roles that you play, because I think what you've shared about intentionality around marriage and parenting likely shows up in the other roles that you play too, yeah, and how you lead and how you build teams and how you coach and consult with clients. So I want to talk about that, but do you have any parenting, marriage, life resources that you would share? It's inspirational to talk to people who are honest about not having it all figured out, yeah, but are committed to the journey.
Yeah. We have gone through a series of different we listen to podcasts a lot. Typically, and when we've fallen off this, we're getting back on track. We'll pick a series and we'll listen to it together as we're making dinner. You know, we kind of have conversations around that. But those change as our relationships change. So there's not a ton of, you know, absolute go-to resources. It kind of depends on what feels true to us as, you know, as we're moving on.
I love it. And that's one of the big benefits, I think, of the podcast world and online in general, which is a good segue to talking a little bit about your agency, but the access to resources, right? I mean, it started obviously with the ability to Google things, and that certainly made information a little bit more accessible and come to our fingertips. But as information networks have continued to get built out, I think it's become a way for us to find that community. Yeah. I have something that's called AERD, which is aspirin exacerbated respiratory disease. Oh. And it's a mixture of asthma, nasal polyps, sensitivity to aspirin. It's unique, right? I mean, it's not something that you hear about. And I spent probably almost 20 years having it, not ever meeting somebody else who had it. And then a couple of years ago, I went on Facebook and I thought, I wonder if I just type it in, is there something there? Does it exist? And I found a Facebook group, and it's been transformative, not only in my care, because I was able to see things that people in other countries were trying or doing. I asked questions during my pregnancy. Has this ever impacted somebody, you know, while they were pregnant? What showed up for you while you were pregnant? And what I found was these people who didn't know me, didn't have any investment in me or my outcomes or who I was. They were so kind and giving and sharing because we automatically had the connection of having this thing, right? And so I just think that there's a lot of beautiful things. There's a lot of challenging things, but there's a lot of beautiful things that access to shared groups,
yes,
right, based on shared or lived experiences. There's a lot of really beautiful things that can come from that.
Yeah, 100%. I think Facebook, some people, they love it or they hate it. And it has, in a way, become a form of causing division. However, as many examples as you can see of that, you can find of people building those communities like you're talking about, people with shared experiences, people that you think you're the only one in the world who's ever, you know, had this condition or had this experience, or, you know, there's so many things. And then once you find out, and the wonderful thing about those communities, and I see them because we manage so many of them, is how genuine people are. And you're right, people that will never meet you in real life are willing to share their experiences, their fears, their remedies, whatever that is, to help serve you. And that, to me, shows the beauty of humanity.
And I think it's this idea of community is something that only exists in that form. Mm-hmm. Animals and other living beings have connection and they show up for each other, but it's more primal. Right. It's from the perspective of protection or safety. And certainly communities can provide that element as well. But something that's so unique to humans is this idea of empathy, right? Mm-hmm. Trying to walk the journey with somebody else. And because in this podcast, we focus specifically on women who are creating community, I see it show up in the way that says, I'm experiencing something myself. And not only do I want to get better or feel better or be more productive or whatever that might be, and I need to find my community to help hold me accountable to that, but I want to give back my experience too, so that someone else who's in my situation can also be improved.
Yeah, 100%. And I know you asked me before we started this if you could share something that we'd been through together, and I said yes, but... And I'll be the one to bring it up. But we just recently had a shared medical procedure. What? I think you were a couple weeks ahead of me.
Yeah, beginning of October, I think, for me.
Okay, so and I was October 13th or 14th. And a mutual friend of ours said, hey, did you know that, you know, Mindy's going through the same thing? Can I connect you? And I thought, okay. And walking through, I mean, I'd seen you, we've talked a little bit here and there.
But not much.
But no, but and walking through that journey and just having someone that I can be transparent with and being like, today's a really hard day or today's a really great day. That, to me, that connection can never be taken away. And it just creates that sense of community on just a whole nother, it just reminds me of the importance of that connection of community and plugging in and allowing yourself to be vulnerable and transparent, because there's people out there who have that same goal of creating an amazing experience for others by sharing what they're going through.
It so that you know, the connection that we made during that time was incredibly valuable in the moment, right? Mm-hmm. It helped me to feel like I was okay. I wasn't going crazy. I was going to be fine, right?
Right.
Because I had many of those days. But what you said just now, that it made it something that could never be taken away.
Yeah.
I would completely echo that. It feels to me, even though there's so much that I still have to know about you,
yeah,
it feels to me like I've known you forever.
Exactly.
I would describe you as a very close friend. If I saw you on the street, I would come over and talk to you. Yeah. I'm here if you need anything from me. And it is amazing to think about it, because I don't actually always dissect how we got together, how we started talking to each other. But it is amazing to think about that it all came from that. And what's even more wild is that most of it was by text.
Yeah.
But it feels so intimate.
Yes, 100%. And it was, I think, in a community of women, we all struggle to find that balance between vulnerability and fear of being judged and how much can I say or what shouldn't I say, or, you know, and we all, in that particular instance, I wasn't afraid of that. It just was a judgment-free zone. And I think that once someone understands that they truly are safe to be themselves and to show up authentically, whether that's a great day, a bad day, or an in-between day, right? That is what creates those connections and makes that community something that can never be broken, really.
I think that's a huge lesson for people that are listening, that are trying to create community around something that they're passionate about, or leaders that are listening, that are trying to build teams. Mm-hmm. For me, I've been able to do it specifically around women. So my real estate team is all women. And I don't necessarily know that it has to look that way for everybody, but I can tell you that one of the drivers of that was to create exactly what you're talking about, which was a safe space mm-hmm. to show up and be able to talk about challenges from the perspective of wanting to live really big lives.
Yes.
Right? Yes. I don't do well. I want to be around positive people. I want to be around change makers. That doesn't mean you don't have bad days, and that doesn't mean that you're not vulnerable.
Right.
It means your experiences are shared with the purpose of seeking a solution.
Yes.
Right?
Absolutely.
And if you can create that type of environment where it's safe to share, where you can create connections amongst the people in the group, so there's a shared journey, or there's some, like what you and I had, some experience that makes us feel very close and we can feed off of each other, I think you can really cultivate a group of people that can far exceed any goals that they ever thought possible.
Yeah.
And the problem is when you take those people and you don't make it safe for them to be vulnerable, you don't make it safe to talk about how family and work intersect, you're not solution oriented, you're not, you know, a lot of our conversations were about solutions. It was like, right. Here's how I feel today.
Yeah.
It's really crappy. And here's something that worked for me. And I think both of us kind of fed off of each other in that way.
100%. And I think that that's key, is being solution oriented for anything, you know, build an environment where people are looking for their first instinct once they identify a problem is to automatically start looking for solutions. And when you have community, I might have a portion of the answer and you have another portion of the answer and she has another portion of the answer. And working together creates, like you said, people who are trying to live a bigger, better life. You don't know what you don't know, right? So when you bring people together who are all forward thinking, of course you create something bigger than you could ever think, because I only have a capacity to this level. And when you add all of these components in, you find yourself living this extraordinary life, even on the hard days, because of who your community is.
Totally. I want to transition into some of the stuff that you do with your marketing agency, because I think a lot of the things that we're talking about show up in a business context as well. So you are the owner of DeBellevue Global Marketing, and you guys help clients in over 19 countries.
Yep.
Is that still right?
Yes.
Generating millions of dollars in sales using digital marketing strategies, helping them engage with their target market audience. I know that you've worked with global conglomerates and real estate moguls, all the way down to individual business owners, and helping people kind of uncover untapped marketplaces. Can you share with us a little bit about how you got into the entrepreneurial space?
Sure.
What that transition looked like? And then let's talk about the clients that really get you excited.
Awesome. So I would not have ever pegged myself. I told you I wanted to be in the medical field. So very black and white, very scientific. What I do now is the extreme opposite of that. But I was working for a doctor, a chiropractor, and he saw that I had talent in the marketing arena. That was not my position with him. He pulled me aside and said, hey, can you, are you willing to try this? And I said, absolutely. I didn't know anything about marketing, but I knew enough to say yes to an opportunity. So literally sat down at my computer and Googled marketing, right? I don't know what I'm doing. And within 2 years, we had doubled our space. We had doubled our employees and we were looking to move into the space next door. And he pulled me into his office and said, I think you need to go do this on your own. I think you can do this. People are asking you. People are asking me. Go do it. And I was okay.
What a way to show up for somebody in your world.
Yeah.
I mean, what an impact that that made on your journey. You likely would have made it there, mm-hmm. but how much did he expedite that process for you?
That's exactly it. And I don't know if I would have ever had the vision, because I didn't grow up around entrepreneurs or business. So I grew up around people who worked 40 years for the same company and you get a retirement, you know, like that's kind of the path that I thought you should be on. And so he sent me, you know, he said, you'll always have a safe place to land, but go do this. And I was like, okay. And so I go home and like, then I sit down and I'm like, Google how to be a business owner, because I don't know. Like, I don't even know what I'm doing. And the first Friday that came where I didn't get a paycheck, I'm so used to direct deposit. Like, I woke up and I looked at my account and I was like, well, who's going to put the money in there? You know, and it kind of helped me realize like the importance of implementing for myself what I had been doing for other people. And that was in December, made 12 years. That was 12 years ago. Yeah.
So your kids were, just to kind of put into context the rest of your world.
Yeah.
You still had pretty young kids at home.
Yes.
Teenagers, early teenagers?
I had.
Preteens?
If I can do, I'm not great at math.
Clearly I'm not either.
I'm 23. She'll be 24 next week. So let me do 24 minus 12. So 12 and 10. 10 and 12.
Okay. So busy years. Not that there aren't busy years, but busy years for kids.
Yeah.
What did that look like as far as schedule and transition? And I'm sure, you know, there's a lot of confines be working for somebody else. I think now that I'm in the entrepreneurial space, I work all of the time. I'm mom all of the time, but the two always intersect. And Absolutely. So I'm in control of that.
Yeah.
For the most part. But when you work within the confines of somebody else's schedule, it's even more difficult, right? There isn't that flexibility. So how did you make that transition with your kids?
I really focused on, I knew how important those preteen and those teenage years were. And I was kind of afraid of them, to be honest, because everyone told me how horrible the teen years were and, you know, that it was the hardest portion of parenting. So I really felt that I was blessed in the fact that I did have that constraint of time, like, kind of lifted off me. And that's when I made it a goal that my children would never feel that I was not available to them. I would, you know, thank goodness we have smartphones, right? And they were still new because I had the Apple III, right? So this is telling you how long ago, a decade ago. And as they would be, you know, at the skate park, I would be responding to emails, or I took business calls at all different kinds of odd hours. At, you know, while the kids are, you know, over here at the mall with their friends, I'm over here in the corner huddled, you know, trying to take a sales call and things along those lines. So I made a lot of sacrifices. At the time, I don't think they realized, you know, kind of what I was doing to give back to them. And I tried to always make them think that I was paying attention, or not let them realize that I was answering emails or text messages or things along those lines.
But moms are masters at this.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And then you are able to be there. And,
yes.
You know, this is a constant conversation for any business owner, anybody who works and has families. I mean, you don't have to be an entrepreneur to have to figure out how to manage two completely different roles in your life that are both full-time roles, right?
Yeah.
But it comes up in the entrepreneurial space all of the time. And trying to, I don't like to use the word balance, but trying to figure out the right mix of showing up while also being able to work, and then the times that we have to completely shut down and be wholly present. And it really becomes an entire family conversation, right? You're all in that conversation together, and kids are old enough to be a part of that conversation. And I think that we do a disservice to our kids if we don't engage them in that, because eventually they're going to be likely in the same scenario. And if nobody ever talked to them about what those challenges look like, how to navigate them, what's okay, what's not okay, they're going to be starting over every time. And what's so interesting about your story is that, like me and like many other people on this podcast, they are the first generation of entrepreneurs in their family.
Right.
Right. So we're all Googling, like we're all trying to figure out what this looks like. Imagine what a gift you can now give to your kids that you can share with them what it looks like to work in the corporate space, what it works like, looks like to have a schedule, because certainly they'll have to decide which path is best for them, but you can educate them on what you experienced as a child, what your parents went through. You can experience what you went through as your in your first sort of career, foray into career, and then you can share with them what it looks like to be an entrepreneur and what the very real challenges and schedules and, you know, what all of that looks like, so that they're not starting from scratch if they choose to go down that path.
Yeah. And I think, you know, so an important point you brought up that honestly highlights something that I wish I could go back and do differently. So I know you have a young son, like you still have a lot of parenting. Like,
I know,
left
like,
to
stop
do.
Telling me it gets harder.
But no, it's totally easy. Once you get past four, it's all, no. But one thing I wish I had done better was talk to them about the challenges I was experiencing, because they don't see it. They see the success and they think, oh, well, I just have to answer some emails and send out a couple texts and I should be successful, right? So really kind of talking to them about what that journey looks like and letting them know, hey, I've been up since four, so I'm not gonna cook you breakfast. I need you to grab a bowl of cereal. And I never really wanted them to see that, because I didn't want them to feel that they were a cause of the struggle or a limitation to the business, you know, side of it. But at the same time, it didn't show them what it really is. And it didn't give them, I think, realistic expectations of what true business ownership is, if that makes sense.
100%. And I think it's also this idea of, and I'm learning this as an adult, so I certainly don't want to pass this onto my child and make him have to figure this out 40 years later. But you can share experiences without sharing ownership.
Yes.
And that's, I think, a big one.
That's powerful.
Right. Yeah. I mean, we want to hide stuff from our kids because we don't want them to put it on their shoulders.
Yeah.
And you can communicate and be transparent and teach and engage and involve without giving them the idea that it's on their shoulders to fix or to solve. You are still the parent. You're in charge. You'll take care of it. They're fine. They're safe. They are your number one priority.
Yeah.
And this is what it looks like in a day in the life of mom.
Yeah, exactly. Right? And also, I think I'm learning, and I'm really learning by watching. We want to talk about social media. Like, I follow you on social media. I see that you unplug. You know, I've got friends who are like, you know what? Here's my boundary. At 7 o'clock, my phone goes off. I spend time with my family and things along those lines. And I started that January 1. My phone at 7 o'clock shuts down and you get the little notification of notifications are silenced.
How much business have you lost since then?
None. No, not at all.
People understand expectations when you set boundaries for them. And I think we come from such a place of fear, and it's good because we have drive and we understand, we feel responsibility and we want to show up for our clients.
Yeah.
There's so many times that I've made decisions, and this still is an ongoing practice, right? But you make these decisions and your clients give you glowing reviews and say that they felt like you were always available for them.
Yeah. 100%. And when you can show up as your best self, you provide a different level of service, right? Well, I don't think you can show up as your best self if you're pouring from an empty cup or if you're feeling distracted because you've got 15 other things. I think most women on average have, you know, 40 other things going on in their, like, I'm thinking like, did I pick this up from the store? Do I have to do this today? As I'm answering a question, something along those lines. However, you know, making sure that you're intentional with, you know, the time that you spend with your children or the time you spend with your spouse or whoever, your community, making sure that that time is focused and not just running from one thing to another to check boxes off.
Totally.
Allows you to show up and to participate and to give back and to receive in a way that, for me at least, restores me to who I know I am.
Yeah.
If that makes sense.
Yeah, absolutely. So talk to me about how do you do this in your business world? What are you coaching? Who comes to you? What problems do they have? How do you solve them? Tell me what you guys do.
Yeah. And had we not done this podcast, I don't know if I would have connected what we do to community in this way. But what people come to us, businesses from, we work with some of the largest corporations in the world, to the lawn guy or the pool guy, or, you know, people who know that they are doing their life's purpose. They just know that they're not getting in front of the right people, right? They can be the best at what they do, but if no one knows about it, it doesn't matter that you're the best, right? It's the kind of the loudest gets the most attention. So what we do is we bring business owners in and we help them understand who their community is and how to speak to them in a way that grows their business organically and authentically and for the long haul. We're not looking for that. Of course, we run ads and we've got some shorter term projects, but in general, it's about building their own community, right?
And so what are some of the tips that you have for those folks? What are some of the things that show up time and time again? How do they do that?
The biggest thing, and that's a great question, is they're afraid to be honest with who they want to talk to, who they want to attract, who their target market is. Just because you have a target market, that does not mean that you're excluding anyone else. It just means that these are the people who you know you are meant to help, and here's how you're meant to help them, right? And it's creating messages that resonate with those people so that you can make that impact on a larger scale. That's all that is. And people are so afraid to limit themselves, right? The other thing is really kind of honing down on your service. You don't have to be everything to everyone. Know what you do and do it well. It's that simple.
I love the idea of clarity because I think what happens is a lot of business owners, like you said, they're afraid to close their audience or limit their potential, when in reality what they're doing is they're just not getting specific enough about who they serve or what kind of experience they want to provide to those people because they don't have a people. Right. If you serve everybody, which of course, as business owners, we are open to business with everybody.
Right.
But if you aren't clear on who your passion is, how can you tailor your experience or tailor the services that you provide? Even if you just say something like women, well, all women are not the same. Yeah, are we talking about women with little kids, women without kids, women that are married, women that own businesses? I mean, women is like a very broad category in its own right, right?
Yeah.
So if you aren't taking the time to get specific about who you serve, how can you possibly create a customized experience for them?
Yeah. And it's in that customization that is going to grow your business. It's going to get you to that level. It's going to create the testimonials that you're looking for and the, you know, the word of mouth business and the social media tags and all of these things that create long-term sustainable business can all be found when you identify who your community is, who your ideal client is, and what it is you're bringing to the table.
So you're doing consulting for these companies and figuring out what is their message, who are they trying to talk to, how do they get it across, what are the vehicles for doing that, what are some of the specific services that you provide?
So not only do we do consultation, we are pretty much a complete third-party marketing company. So website, SEO, social media, any advertising, Google. We will handle all of the creation of the messaging, the posting, the scheduling. Words like algorithms don't need to scare business owners anymore because we've got that handled for them, right? So we're really looking at everything. And we set, something that sets us apart is that we set quarterly goals for our clients, right? We don't just send you a report that go, oh, you're doing great and your phone's not ringing, right? We go, here's what we're going to achieve this quarter. Here's what we want to see. We get feedback from them to make sure that the numbers that we're seeing in the reports correlate with, you know, the business growth that they're expecting. So we do that all for them. They pretty much hand it off to us and let us kind of run with it.
So now that you've been in business for 12 years, you said, right? Uh-huh. How has your passion for serving your clients change? So as you talk about that customization, that unique experience, that specific audience, how has who you want to work with changed over time?
So we have two very different aspects of our company. We have the corporate side, which our team handles. That's the, you know, the larger and the international. We have stuff out of Dubai. I don't speak Arabic. Like, I can't do any of that stuff. So we have that side of that division of the company. But for me personally, the one that I am most passionate about, I do handle a particular book of business, and it's local. It's people that I'm going to run into at the grocery store or at the chamber event or things along those lines. And the clients that light me up the most are people who are doing their life's purpose regardless of their industry. So like your industry is real estate. What we're doing right here is allowed because you've created what you have in your industry. Does that make sense? You know what I mean?
Completely. I feel so honored as a business owner that I've been able to create my journey and my path and to cultivate what's around me. And when you first start your business, your primary function is to build your audience and build your following and start to create a community of people who really want to work with you. Yeah. And as you start to build the income and the brand and the community awareness, then you have to likely start to build out a team to support those needs, right? You go from being able to handle it yourself to being able to build a team. So then you shift in your skill set to focus on leadership. And really have to go, at least from my experience, through a journey of finding out what that meant to me. And in a lot of ways, getting rid of a lot of the examples that I had been shown and really figure out what felt right to me. That's a lot of trial and error. I screwed up a lot. I still have some PTSD from those times. But it gets better over time as you get clearer. But you really shift from, you know, looking for clients, building a brand, creating awareness. Then you have to kind of move into the leadership space to build your core components in order to be able to support that. Mm-hmm. And then at some point you shift into, you know, making sure that your systems and your tools and the inner workings of your business can now support external and internal growth.
Right.
And then you get to this really beautiful space where you get to start to look at other ways in which your brand and the business that you've built can now show up for yourself and for your community.
Yes. And that's so beautifully said. And I work with people in two completely different areas. In the very beginning, when they're trying to figure out their brand and their voice and the content, right? So at the very beginning stages, typically, I mean, not brand new, but 3 to 5 years in, right? And then again, we stick with them, but then we get to have a very different journey that starts all over again once they get to that beautiful space where they're like, okay, now I want to create something bigger. And it's that thing that they've known that they've always wanted to do, but they thought there's no way I'm ever going to be able to do that. Or it's scary, right? To think I'm going to put myself out there and I'm known for all of, you know, this brand and all of these things, but this is what I really want to do. That is, once they get to that spot, that is where we can dive in and work and create that vision on a totally different level. And that what you just explained is my passion, is helping people at that level.
So what have you learned as your business has grown? Challenges personally, trying to manage family and life and kids? What have you learned from your clients? What are some of your greatest lessons? I feel like that decade mark is a really great space. It's also very internally challenging because you feel in some ways you've mastered some things. And so you feel like this push to what's next? What's the next thing? Where do I go from here? Yeah. But I do feel like it's that experience that you talked about that you now have under your belt. What are some of the best lessons you've learned?
I think, and this is still a very new lesson for me, and I have to remind myself of it, is that when I show up in my authentic self, that is what gives other people permission to be that. And that is where the magic happens. It doesn't mean that you, you know, overshare and tell, you know, you're not a hot mess 24/7 because we're, you know, it's about just showing up and saying, you know, I don't know the answer to that, but I'm going to find out. Or, you know, working with people that you know are just brilliant and telling them, like, I'm here to learn from you, or I believe that this is a shared experience, right? That has been a huge lesson for me. The other thing is, and I mentioned this kind of, you said we were on a panel, never be the smartest person in the room. I always look, you know, community is great, but if I was still in that same community I was when I was 19 or 21 or even 30, right? As you evolve and change, you have to realize that sometimes that means your community evolves and changes. That doesn't mean you can't be friends with people. It just means that your core people sometimes change, and they always need to be challenging you to be the best version of yourself. And if they see you not being that, lovingly calling you out on that, right? And just making sure that I'm always surrounded by people who want the best for themselves and those around them.
I think one of the traits that I see in very successful women and ones who are intentionally creating community is that they know when it's time to move on to a new community.
Yeah.
Right. We spoke with another guest who talked about the concept of, instead of a circle, it's from the Untamed book, instead of a circle, it's like the idea of a horseshoe. You can find your way in and you can find your way right back out. And I think that that is certainly a trait, that understanding how to fit into a community, find the community. That's a skill that I think that we need to build in the future generations, so that they're not finding themselves in need of a community and don't know how to get it.
Yes.
Because once you know how to find it, to cultivate it, to be a part of it, to show up for it, it becomes routine. And then when you know that it doesn't fit for you anymore, you don't just eject and kind of go back into your hole and deal with life until you need it again. You automatically seek out the next community to be a part of.
Yeah, 100%. Beautiful.
So a couple last questions for you.
Sure.
Along the way, I'm sure that there have been, as you've learned these lessons and grown your business and started to hone in on the ones that really give you passion and started to create some extra projects for yourself, I'm sure that there were supporters and there were naysayers. Mm-hmm. Who are some of those people for you?
They have evolved. I think that my children have been my biggest champions. They have this amazing idea of who they think I am, which I hope I never, like, I hope they never wake up to, you know, kind of the who I see myself as a mom. I hope one day I can see myself the way that they see me. But my children have been my biggest champions. My husband is my biggest supporter. He tells me all the time, I will always be your number one fan. But the women business owners that I have come in contact with these last 10 years have been absolutely amazing. There was, and even a couple women who have that entrepreneurial spirit, but were still somehow, you know, kind of working for someone else, that championed me. And when I was scared or when I was unsure of something, they were my courage. They were the ones that were like, we got you, we got this, you know, and really helped me understand the importance of having that, you know, that group of supporters. And then I remember Brené Brown. I love her. She was talking about the man in the arena, right? If you're not in the arena fighting, you don't have to be fighting the same battle. But if you're an entrepreneur, then yes, I want to know what your thoughts are. I want to hear your criticism. How can I get better? But if you're not in the arena with me, you don't get a right to say anything to me. And I really took that to heart, right? That changed, because when you reach a certain level of success, my business went from 0 to 6 figures in about 5 months. I didn't know that that was not standard. I don't know what you're supposed to make. You know, like, I was like, okay. And I started getting more and more naysayers, and I didn't know what to do with that. And I started to take it to heart. And that's when someone pointed me to Brené and said, like, you need to listen to this, because the bigger and more successful you get, the more people you're going to have that are going to point faults out, and they're never the people in the arena. So that's kind of how I learned to deal with those. Some days are better than others, obviously, but
the takeaway there is so incredible because there will always be naysayers. And I always say that my biggest naysayers are the ones that tell me to think not quite as big.
Yes.
Right? Yeah. Don't work so hard. Don't do more. Try to find a way to do less. Be less passionate. Don't care so much.
And I've personally found that a lot of times that's our family and closest friends. And I think that comes from a desire to keep us safe, right? They don't want us to go out too far because they don't want us to fall or to do this or to do that. Mm-hmm. And to understand that it's coming from a place of love, mm-hmm. and not necessarily, it's not that they want to see you fail, right? If they do, then they probably shouldn't be part of your circle. But if you consider them in your circle and they're, you know, they're just smaller thinkers and they're giving advice based on, you know, kind of their life experience, and to be brave enough to go out there and do it anyways.
Well, I want you to stay in my circle forever.
Yes.
So if people want to get in community with you, Leanna, how do they find you? How can they get a hold of you? What can they follow that you follow?
So I am everywhere on social media, obviously. Like, I try and make sure that my presence is pretty big out there. You can hashtag the DeBellevue life. That's kind of me, my stories, my ups, my downs, everything in between. That's our family life, but I share a lot of the entrepreneurial journey on there. Through our website, they can DM me, they can on Instagram, they can follow. I'm pretty responsive. Our team goes through all of those preliminary ones, but for anything for me personal, they send to me, so it comes directly to me.
Well, I really appreciate you joining us today, Leanna, and I hope that folks will take you up on getting into community with you, because you've been so incredibly valuable to my life. And I hope that we can continue this conversation again in the future. And for those of you that are listening out there, if you enjoyed today's conversation on intentionally creating community, please continue to listen to us here at Community on Purpose and follow us wherever it is that you are listening to your podcasts. Each week, I'll leave you with a quote. And today, in thinking about our conversation, this one just seems right. And it's, the future isn't a place that we're going to go. It's a place that you get to create.
Ooh, I love that.
So thank you so much for joining us, and we'll see you guys next time.
This podcast is brought to you by the Amy Jones Group, your residential real estate team serving the East Valley. On a mission to thrive, the Amy Jones Group is committed to helping you go further, faster, through home ownership and community giving. For more information, visit amyjonesgroup.com.